Hi everyone. So today we'll be working in the official ACT prep guidebook. So turn to the first practice test and we'll be working on questions 1 through 5 in the math section. So that's starting at page 55. Okay, so first question says, which of the following is expressed of the expressions is equivalent to a times 4 minus a minus 5 times a plus 7? So let's first write that out. So a times 4 minus a minus 5 times a plus 7. We want to find some sort of expression that's equivalent to this. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to expand this equation because that's the easiest way to work with it. So we get 4a minus a times minus a gives you a times a minus 5 times a plus 5 times 7, which is 35. So we can add like terms together, right? So we get 4 minus 5a minus, this becomes a squared plus 35. And when you take this equation, you get negative a squared, sorry, we get negative a minus a squared plus 35. So now we're going to look at our answers and the answers that they give us and see if there's anything, any expression that matches up to this equation or any of these. So we see that C is equal to this, right? So if we rearrange this and say negative a squared minus a minus plus 35, we see that this is equal to the C option on the test. So we circle C and we're done. So, great. The next question is a little bit different. So the next question says, we want to order the following inequalities from least to greatest. And this is 0.2, 0.03, and 1/4. So the easiest way to do these kinds of problems is to start off by saying, how can we order these and put them all in the same form? So considering that two of these are already in decimal form, it might be easiest for us to just convert 1/4 to a decimal. So when you think about it, fractions are just glorified division problems. So when you take this, this is equivalent to saying 1 divided by 4. And so that you put a 1 here and a dot for decimal, and we add a 0 here. 2 is our remainder. Add another 0, and we get 5. So we know now that 1/4 equals 0.25. Therefore, now we have three decimals to work with. We have 0.2, 0.03, and 0.25. So we know now then that 0.03 is the smallest, 0.2 is the second smallest, and 0.25, or 1/4, is the third largest. So of all of our options then, we know that G is the right answer because it gives us 0.03 is less than 2.2, which is less than 0.25 or 1/4. All right, so our third problem is now that it's also algebra. So we say if x squared plus 4 equals 29, then x squared minus 4 equals something. So we could do this by solving for x and then plugging in our value for x into this equation, but there's an even easier way to do it. So let's start off with our given, which is x squared plus 4 equals 29. Next, we know that x squared equals 29 minus 4 when we subtract 4 on both sides. So we get that x squared equals 25. So you could go ahead and say, oh, x is equal to plus or minus 5, which is great. But the thing is that if you see what we want to find, which is x squared minus 4, we still just need an x squared. So we can just plug in this value of x squared, which is 25, into this statement that we want to show. So then, given that x squared equals 25, we can say here that 25 minus 4 equals our question mark. So our question mark equals 21, which is C. All right, fourth question. Fourth question's a little bit different from the one we've done so far. So in the fourth question, we have a rectangle, and their coordinates are negative 1, negative 2, 4, and negative 2, 4 and 3, and negative 1 and 3. So these are our four coordinates. So we want to find what percent of this area of this rectangle falls in the third quadrant. So let's start off by drawing a coordinate plane, our typical Cartesian plane. So this is x and this is y. So, we should probably also put some coordinates. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Perfect. So, four. So, when we look at the question, we can first off by plotting our points. This is negative 1, 2, so this is point A. 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, negative 2, which is point B. 4 and positive 3, just right here. And negative 1, positive 3, which is right here. So this is sort of a rough outline of what our rectangle looks like. So I have this beautiful rectangle drawn by yours truly. And so we want to see what percent of it falls within the third quadrant. So remember now that this is the first quadrant, this is the second quadrant, this is the third quadrant, and this is the fourth quadrant. Therefore, we want to see what percent of the area is this area. So think back to when we drew out this rectangle. This coordinate right here is the coordinate negative 1, negative 2. So, since this is negative 1, negative 2, we know that this right here is the origin, which is 0, 0. We can figure out that from here to here, it is the y-coordinate of this coordinate, which is 2, and this distance right here is 1, right? Because in order to get to this coordinate in the first place, you have to go from the origin, go back 1, and go down 2. Therefore, we know that the dimensions of this rectangle that we want to find is 1 and 2. So the area that we want, we'll call that A star, is equal to 1 times 2, which is the area of any rectangle, right? The area of its height and length. The multiplication of its height and length. So we know that A star is equal to 2. Now we want to find the area of the entire rectangle. So looking at this entire rectangle, we'll call the entire area A. So the entire area is equal to the base times the height. So looking at this problem, we can see that given this is negative 1, 3, this is 4, 3, and this is 4, negative 2, we can say that the distance between this, which is also the base, is 5. And the distance from here to here, which is also our height, is equal to 5 as well, I believe. Yes, it's equal to 5 as well. So we have a 5 by 5 rectangle, which means that the area is equal to 5 times 5, which is 25. So the question asks us to find the percentage of the area of the rectangle that's found in the third quadrant. In other words, the question wants us to find, let's erase this right here, sorry. So the question wants us to find A star over A, but in percentage form. So A star over A is just equal to 2 over 25. And they want us to find this fraction in terms of a percent. So an easy way to think about this is to say 2 over 25, is there a way we can make this fraction into something over 100? And so a way we can do that is by multiplying the top and the bottom by 4, because 25 times 4 gives you 100. So you get that A star over A, or the area in that selected region in the third quadrant over the total area of the rectangle, equals 8 over 100, which is also known as 8%. And that is also the answer, which is F. Great. So last one is number 5. So number 5, this one is sort of a graphing question as well, but it's more algebraic. This one, it says, in 1985, the cost of clothing for a certain family was $620. In 1995, 10 years later, the cost of clothing for the family was $1,000. Assuming the cost increased linearly, what is the cost of this family's clothing in 1991? So this is one of the ACT's famed word problems. They're not really famous, but we're going to call them famous. But essentially, there's only a few things that you really need to pick out of this question. So first is that 1985, the cost of family clothing is $620. But in 1995, the cost of clothing was $1,000. Another important thing to understand is that this relationship is linear. That's something that's very important, so underline that. So it's a linear relationship, and we know one endpoint and another endpoint in this graph, or in this linear relationship. So we can construct our own linear model. So we're going to let this model be year versus cost of clothes. This is going to be the year, and this will be cost. So we have 2 points here, 1985 and 1995. Similarly, we also have two costs, 620 and 1,000. So we'll just let this be 620 and this be 1,000. Clearly, this is not a to scale graph, but that's not what matters. So we have this right now. This is our linear relationship. And so when we look at this, we know that when we have two endpoints of a line, we can find the slope of that line. So let's start by finding the slope. So we'll say m equals 1,000, or y2, minus 620, y1, over 1995, x2, minus 1985, x1. And that gives us 380 over 10, or 38. So now we have that there's 38 is our slope. That means as each year increases, the cost of clothes increases by 38. So between the years of 1985 and 1986, if this linear relationship is true, which is what they tell us it is, that means that the cost of clothes will go up from 620 to 620 plus 38. So we have our slope, which tells us the rate of change. That means that we can find the rate of change from 1985 to 1991? Yeah, 1991. So first of all, we should see what the change in x is, right? So remember that m equals change in y over change in x. So if that's true, then we can say that the change in x, first of all, is from 1985 to 1991, which is a solid 6 years. That means that our change in x equals 6. Second of all, we want to find the change in y, which is what we're trying to solve for. So we let m be 38, which is what we just found earlier. So 38 equals 6 over change in y. And we know change in y is equal to 600, sorry, is equal to the cost of clothes in 1991 minus the cost of clothes in 1985, which is 620. Therefore, we can say 38 equals x minus, we'll use something else actually, we'll use c minus 620 over 6. So we can cross multiply and we get c minus 620 equals 228, I believe. So c equals 228 plus 620, which is 848, Or, as our answer says, choice B. Great. That was all the questions from 1 through 5 and all the answers. I hope that helped, and if that didn't, look at your